You know that Keeley Companies is all about fostering the world-class culture through their incredible cultural pillars. Well, it was time to add a seventh cultural pillar, Keeley Green. Guided by the mission to raise the sustainability standards by which they design, build, operate, and live, Keeley Green is dedicated to using a holistic approach to leave a positive impact on our environment, create a future that is sustainable for generations to come. In the words of Rusty Keeley, we are just getting started. You can learn more about that just getting started mentality and all the work they do by visiting my friends at Keeley Companies online at keeleycompanies.com.
Welcome to the Live Inspired podcast with John O'Leary. John is the number one national best-selling author of the book On Fire. He's a world-class inspirational speaker, and he's the host of the Live Inspired podcast. John interviews extraordinary individuals on their life story so that you can wake up from accidental living and more fully live your life story. Here's your host, John O'Leary.
Hello, my friends, and welcome to the Live Inspired podcast with John O'Leary. I, over the weekend, had an opportunity of watching a film that will be rolling into theaters in about 14 months or so. Stay tuned. That film is called On Fire. It is a beautiful story, but it was also directed by an amazing human being. This project would not have happened without Sean McNamara. Sean McNamara read a script for a film called On Fire about 6.5 years ago, fell in love with it, has remained in love with it throughout the entire project, and has just finished completing that film. It's an incredible journey that he and I have been on together. You're going to learn his story today, not only in regards to On Fire, which I think you're going to love, but you're also going to learn the story of an incredible human being. I have the joy of working with and partnering with some of the greatest leaders from some of the biggest organizations from around the world. And I've never worked with a finer leader and a more humble, successful guy than Sean McNamara. He's simply remarkable. I think when you hear his story, you're going to understand maybe why. From a big family, maybe that's a little bit of it. Reminded to be humble by his parents the entire time, but at the same time to dream big about his life, challenged to do mighty things, but to never forget the little guy. He learned creativity. He learned directorial skills. He learned selfless love, and he learned ultimately how to build something bigger than himself. What has that led to? Well, it's led to more than 40 films, including Soul Surfer, which so many folks have seen, Miracle Season, Spare Parts, on and on and on. One of the films many people are seeing right now because it is the number one film in America right now is Reagan. It is a phenomenal film. If you haven't seen it yet, let me encourage you to go check it out. I really do think, regardless of how you decide to vote in November 2024 or how you voted in November 1980 or 84, you will love the film. And I know you're going to love this man's heart. So let me step out of the way and bring Sean in. We recorded this in his office in Southern California a couple months back. But with the release of Reagan, the success that it is enjoying, and with some exciting news around On Fire that we'll be sharing with you in the next couple weeks and months, we thought maybe now is the perfect time to share the life story of my friend and soon to be yours. His name is Sean McNamara. Sean, welcome to Live Inspired with John O'Leary.
Oh, I'm so glad to be here. Thank you.
Well, we're actually at your home. Why don't you tell our listeners and viewers where we're recording this episode today?
We are in beautiful Southern California in Manhattan Beach at the Manhattan Beach Studios, where it's our Brookwell McNamara Entertainment headquarters, and we're in a conference room. And it is a beautiful, sunny Southern California day out there today. So it's great to be here.
So, Sean McNamara, I will do a more formal introduction when you're not in this boardroom, because I don't want you to blush when I'm introducing you to our viewers and listeners. But I love you. I respect you. I love your heart and your work. But for those who had not met you yet, if you had to introduce yourself, you're at a grocery store and they extend their right hand, you extend yours, and they say, Sean, what do you do? How do you respond to that?
I usually just say, if it's the short version, I'm a filmmaker and I do inspirational movies like Soul Surfer, Miracle Season, Spare Parts, and of late, On Fire. That's what I kind of do. And then I find out how much they know, and then I'll just start telling them my whole life story.
Let's tell that whole life story. I want to hear a lot more about directing some of those films you mentioned, including On Fire. But all this came out of your childhood.
Yeah.
Like, you are the recipient of this incredible childhood. Big family, Irish Catholic family, mom and dad are on the table. Let's go back in time a few years. Talk first about your dad.
Sure. My dad was in the Korean War, and then he went on and became a teacher, a principal, and then a superintendent in the LA Unified School District. My mom was a housewife. She was a teacher also, I think, when they met. And then they raised six kids, and I'm the baby of those six kids. And apparently, we all have Irish names like Nancy, Eileen, Colleen, Kathleen, Maureen. And if I was a girl, I was going to be Noreen. But apparently Kathleen was praying for a boy, so we got Sean. And then there was my older brother, Michael. So, yeah, there was the eight Macs always everywhere. We'd spend our summers in San Diego because that's where my mom's dad lived. And so I had this idyllic childhood that I would be surfing all summer, playing in the sand. I mean, literally, my mom would send me out at 8 o'clock in the morning and say, come back at 5. And we would just play, my friends, we'd build totem poles, we'd go swimming, we'd go surfing. Always in June, I got my first big red burn of the summer. And by September, I was tan. And I was just like a little Grom in Mission Beach, San Diego. And it was great.
I've read and heard from others and from you a couple times that your mother believed in you.
Oh, yes.
Anything you thought you could do, she would say basically, Sean, you can do it.
It was a very positive upbringing. I mean, when I was 12 years old, we took a family trip to Ireland. And I remember my dad bought me a Super 8 camera. And that was like the first introduction I got into it. So to me, it was like a toy. It's not like today where everybody has a phone and they could make movies. To me, it was like, ooh, this film thing. And I could point the camera. The first footage I took was leaving the Shannon Airport where my dad bought the camera. And I shot out the window. It was a rainy Irish day. From that point, I started making all these little films, and I'd use my neighbors as cast members, and they were intense. One was like Sniper, and it would be starring me with a BB gun, and I would climb up the tree and go on the roof, and then I would shoot at my friend who would put ketchup in his mouth, and he'd spit it out. And I had no understanding of editing. Like, I would go shoot one shot, and then I'd run down and shoot the other shot. Then I'd run back up on the roof and shoot the next shot. But then I started showing them to my friends at school and to my teachers at school. And I found out that I could get out of doing homework and tests if I would make these little films. So all of a sudden I went, this is fun. And I could get credit for it. And very quickly when I learned, and my dad bought me the projector and everything, when I would play these little films and the class would clap at the end. I mean, that was it. As soon as all of a sudden there was like attention from doing these little films, I just absolutely loved it. And I just continued that on into high school. And I got into acting. I was in all the plays in high school. But I always felt more comfortable behind the camera because I got nervous. To stand up, I was very nervous standing in front of people. And I could do it. I could say the lines. But I'd always hear the actors saying, oh, I felt so at home up there. And it was just so beautiful. And I was like, I feel nothing but like I'm at home when I'm in front of people. I feel really nervous and really scared. I think I did Hair my senior year of high school, and that's when we were supposed to be doing nude scenes. And of course, I was wearing Speedos or whatever. But after that, I was just, I don't know if I can keep doing this. I want to get into a school that had like cinematography in it. So I ended up going on to Loyola Marymount University and to Santa Clara University, taking film, television, theater history. I did plays. I did musicals. I did Jesus Christ Superstar.
When you say I did Jesus Christ Superstar, you performed, put on, produced?
Well, in high school, I performed in these ones, but in college, I directed them. And wow. I really enjoyed that. And I would just get all my friends. And so I was never nervous about that. I had no problem directing people. And then they were in front of the audience the night of the performances. So I just enjoyed sitting in the audience and watching it. So it was just fantastic. But I love the idea of like making a play. Mm. And since I'd been doing it since I was 12 years old, it was easy. And I would just, no matter what I could see, it just always came to me how to do it, what to do with it. And so I've been continuing to do that since. And then I got lucky a few times. I loved the entertainment business. I started out like as a PA after I graduated college. And they would like say, Sean, go wash my Mercedes Benz. And I would be like driving somebody's Mercedes-Benz down Hollywood Boulevard. And I always thought, this is the greatest job in the world. Or, you know, I would be pouring their coffee and go, by the way, I am a director if you ever need one. And they'd kind of laugh. But I got to sit in on all these writer meetings and all of that stuff. So it was just, it was fun. And it's never stopped being fun. And at one point, my boss said, I got $500 and I want to, my brother owns the Hartford Modern School of Welding. And could you just put a slide up on the screen and just, you know, do that for my brother? And I went, sure, but can I use all this equipment you have? And he said, yes. And I said, can I use all these sets you have? And he said, yes. So literally 3 or 4 weeks later, I produced, directed, and wrote 6 commercials. And it was like Flashdance with people welding and all of this welding fire coming from the sky. And whoever had a Porsche at that time would say, can I borrow your car for like a half hour? And I'd have the actor drive up and pull his hat off and go, Hartford Modern School of Welding, go for it. And I played these 6 commercials for my boss, and his jaw was on the table because he only gave me $500. And I did fully produced commercials because all my buddies worked for free. And mainly what I did was just buy lunch. So the next time around, he says, I'll give you $5,000. We're going to do these PSAs. And he goes, I want to do it for Special Friends of the Children, which was an organization back then, and the Salvation Army and Mothers Against Drunk Driving. So same thing. I said, can I spend it the way I wanted? And it was actually during the 1988 strike. And I wasn't Directors Guild or Writers Guild or anything, but I got all my friends. And I used 35 millimeter cameras by this time. It was getting big time. And I shot these 17 commercials on the back lot of Universal because just nobody was there. And they let me just go at it. We shot music videos. We shot commercials. We shot all these PSAs for $5,000. And all of a sudden, I showed it to him, and he just couldn't believe it because I was just like playing. I was just like, all my friends come, write, direct, act, duet, whatever, but we made those. So then the next thing came, and it was $500,000 to do my first movie. And I was 27 years old, and some German guy, Charles T.M. Cohen, gave me $500,000 to make a movie about a woman who came from Ohio to Hollywood to get into the entertainment business. So, and all of a sudden, I'm doing a real movie, and it was the best thing in the world because I was learning while I was going. I hadn't been to film school. I had been to theater. But when you're actually physically doing it, it's something completely different. So,
were you ready for that level of film at that point?
I think I was ready for it, but what I didn't understand is script is everything. And so what happened is I had a good script and he didn't want to make that script. And he had an idea that he wanted written from scratch. And what I learned from that movie is, you know, the execution of a great script is everything, because then you can get the greatest actors, the greatest camera people, but what's on the page ends up in your movie and you have to have that good. So I made a decent movie, but I learned so much about storytelling and everything. And it was the greatest feeling in the world. So,
yeah. So I want to spend a little bit more time with your directorial career, but not before we go back in time to when you said I was pouring coffee and loving it. A lot of folks these days view like the work they do as being below them, whether it's pouring coffee. You mentioned I had to wash someone's Mercedes and I was laughing. Talk about that, because I think you're hitting on something that is incredibly important and overlooked by many of us.
So I just felt so blessed and so lucky to get to work in the entertainment business at all. I had nobody related to me. My family was in the teaching business for my sisters are teachers. We knew no one who was in the entertainment industry that we could go and ask. So I figured, and they figured, if you go to school and learn the craft of how to write and direct and all of that, that would be helpful. Mm. But so when I got out, you start out as what's called a PA, a production assistant, and they will let you do whatever they need. If you need to deliver tapes across town, if you have to deliver a script. In those days, they were hard scripts, so they would print out the script for an actor, and they'd give you an address, and you drive to their house and leave it on their front porch. That was my job. And I just thought this was the coolest thing in the world. But I always did hang out. Like, I would read the script. Like, when there was a script to be delivered, I would want to know, how does this work? And I would read it. And I would drive, and it was just fun. And that was back in the days where once you did your errand, you would have a roll of quarters, and you'd have to call back into the office and go, okay, I delivered the script to Ruth Buzzy's house. What's next? And that's what I did. So I got this feeling of just anything was possible. And then I actually did do audio, my business. My friend's dad, when I did get to high school, he directed the Academy Awards. And I'd always ask my friend Marty Jr., can't I get a meeting with your dad? Please let me, you know, meet this guy. And he would never like kind of let me do it. So when I was in college, I was asking him again, and he finally got a meeting with his dad. And it was in Beverly Hills, and I walked into his office, and it was Marty Pesetta Sr., and he directed the Academy Awards. Like, he was a big shot. And I had no idea what I was doing, but I went in there and sat down. He goes, so, kid, what do you do? A question I was completely unprepared for. And I was like, at that point, I was in a band with my buddies, and we played music. We played Irish music. You know, like, hey, Johnny McGlory, tell me, where's your glory gone? I saw you up on the mountain with your old leg on. I mean, it was just, I had fun. But in that meeting, all I could think of, I plug in microphones. So I said, I know how to plug in microphones. And he goes, audio, that's for you. And so the next thing I know, I'm on an airplane to Washington, D.C., plugging in microphones for President Reagan's inauguration. Just out of the blue, yeah. They made me an A2, which was an audio assistant. And again, a limo came to my house. Four of my sisters are looking through the windows. I was never so embarrassed. But it was just this life of being able to go and do stuff and be around the magic. And it was magic. The microphones, the cameras, going to Washington, D.C., staying at a hotel, binders with everybody's phone number and addresses. It was every part of it was an adventure. So it didn't matter what level of it I was on. It was just that I got to be around it. And that's what I just found just so fun to do, just to be around it. Because what's happening is when you're around it, you're meeting people. You're seeing how it's done with none of the real pressure. None of the pressure of once you get the higher jobs, the next jobs up. And I think people think that they can come in at the top and do anything. And I'm imagining some people can, and maybe they just know more from high school. But what I liked is I started at the bottom and I learned a little bit about everything. I learned how important it was to get a script to an actor's house, how important it was to plug in a microphone and that microphone actually worked when the actor would start to speak. And so once I learned those things, I got a job with a little bit more responsibility. And that each time it grew. So by the time I got to the next job, I might, you know, when I was a PA, I worked myself up to a coordinator, an assistant coordinator, then a coordinator, and then like a production manager. And I slowly worked my way up. But I did the job like, you know, for a few months to a year of learning every way. So by the time I got to the next job, I knew what I was doing and was pretty solid in the craft of what that was. But it always came back to, I just wanted to direct. For just some reason, I wanted. And people always go, oh, it's because you wanted to boss people around. And I go, that's not directing. Directing is you just want to tell stories and you want to tell them your way. And so you read scripts and you go, that would make a great story. And how would I tell that story? So I used to love to also watch movies. I mean, I grew up after school coming home and just watching TV. Like, my kids play video games now, probably much better for them. But I would just drop in front of the TV, watch Gilligan's Island. I would watch Star Trek. Whatever was on after school, that was my education. I remember my mom used to go, you know, I don't know what kind of job you're going to get if you just watch TV and movies all day. And now I cut to my life now and I go, well, I watch TVs and movies all day, and now I make TV and movies all day. So it kind of worked out.
You idolize, I understand, Steven Spielberg. Not a shocking name to hear, but what was it about Spielberg's work you looked up to?
Well, I think growing up in the 70s, everybody looked up to Steven Spielberg. He was this young director who seemed to just do the biggest blockbuster movies and Jaws and Indiana Jones. It was just, he was an incredible young guy. So you kind of looked at that, because before, directors were old white-haired guys and they were older, probably because it took so long, you know, to figure out how to do it.
Interesting.
But in the 70s, Time Man of the Year, there's Steven Spielberg on the front, and he looked kind of like you. He was a young dude, and he was... And just the movies he made were so magical. And back in the 80s, they made magical movies. It was just like E.T., and it was like just wow. Or even, I was feeling really bad one day. I was doing audio, and I was plugging in microphones, and it was just a hard day. It was rainy and gray, and we didn't have to get back to work till the evening. And so my buddy, who was my boss, said, why don't we go see this movie? It's called Raiders of the Lost Ark over at the Chinese Theater. And I was like, oh, okay, whatever. I'd never heard of it. Walked into that theater 2 hours later, came out so pumped and so happy. And I stopped myself. Like, so he looked at me like, what's wrong? And I go, I was so like unhappy before I walked into that theater. And 2.5 hours later, I'm on the top of the world. What just happened? And that movie just happened. And he, Steven Spielberg, directed it. And I was like, from that point on, I want to do stuff like that. Just whatever he did to me, I want to continue to do. And it just reminded me, just keep following your dreams and you can do what you want. But you, for me, it was starting at the bottom and learning every little bit. So on films and television, I would do any job I could do. I would be a script supervisor. I'd work in the costume department. I'd work in the camera department. So, but then I'd just ask questions. So what kind of microphone is this? Or what kind of lenses are those? Or what does that do? And I found that most people who were cool would want to say, well, this is a sure lens and it's a this type of thing, or it's this type of camera and you've got a 35 millimeter lens or a 50. And I didn't know what that meant exactly, but I'd say, and I would just ask questions. And then I'd see the 50 millimeter lens up and I'd look into the monitor and say, okay, that's what a 50 millimeter lens looks like. So I started on somebody else's dime with no pressure on me, learning what everything was in the real world and professional. Not just like out of a book in being a student filmmaker where you're just like making your way through it. I was really on real sets with real people doing their craft. And I guess I loved being a student. I was a straight A student to anything to do with film and television. Anything else, I was B's and C's. I was not. But when it came to film and television, I loved what I did and I was passionate about it.
You mentioned Spielberg as being someone you idolized, looked up to the work that he created.
Yes.
What about from a directorial chair, when you were doing sound and lighting and props and everything else you did, who was a director that you worked alongside of and you just saw the way they directed, they led, they envisioned a project forward and brought it to life? What was it about the way they directed that you wanted to model?
Okay, so the director of Animal House, I shadowed him on a TV show called Topper. And there was a lot of visual effects and blue screen back when that was all brand new. His name was John Landis, Adrian John Landis. And what I watched him do is after a take, he would go, "Stupendous!" And I could just see the actors smiling. And then you'd walk up and talk to them. And I had to, you know, stay back and kind of watch. And then after another take, he'd show, "Fantastic!" And I just saw these smiles come on the actors' faces. And sometimes he would go, "That sucked." It was all different versions of it. But from watching John Landis direct, I was able to go, he brings this energy to his craft, and he always takes care of the actors first. He lets them know how good they did right away. And I studied other directors who would like go, action and cut. And then not, he would just be talking to his technical crew and not letting the actors know how good they were and how wonderful they were. So I learned that from him, how to be right in their faces and tell them what a wonderful job they did and get them excited about it to keep, because, you know, filming is 12 hours a day. It's a long time to keep people up and going. And when I was in high school, one of the other things I was a cheerleader. I mean, I would be one of the yell leaders, they called them back at Loyola High School in the day. But we would do cheers and get the football team and get the crowd, you know, riled up. And I always like think, I still have that job. I'm a cheerleader for my actors, for my crew, trying to bring out the best of the best that they have to do. And I just love doing that. So when I watched John Landis do it with his actors, I went, oh, so professional people can do this too. And I just thought, wow, this is, again, still the job for me, is just encouraging people to do the best at their craft, because I can't do what they do. But I look at it and I go, I can take your craft and I can put it into my movie and make it work within that and work with the gold they bring. And I tell you, actors and crew, they bring their gold and all they want to do is use it. So you can have as many ideas as you want and you should use them and communicate with them, but don't underestimate what the actors will bring to you, bring to, on the set, ideas you had no idea about. And I say they bring their gold and we get to play with it and use it. Mm-hmm. So,
how do you provide feedback when it's more constructive?
You mean to help people if their performance isn't
totally
there?
So it's one thing to cheer, like, "Stupendous!" It's another thing to say, "Yeah, that was a miss. How do we make that better?"
Well, it's interesting. I rarely will go, like, "It's a miss," but I say, "Why don't we try it this way?" And this is what I was thinking about that. And it always comes down to, some of the great directors go, you know, faster, slower, louder, softer. I mean, as weird as that sounds, as simple as that sounds, that will be sometimes I will have to go to that level. But I've read the script and they've read the script. And one of the biggest things I really enjoy is having a little bit of rehearsal, even if it's a day or two, that we've gone through the script. In theater, you get to do this. You literally rehearse every scene ad nauseum to get it ready for the audience because it has to go live for 2 hours. In movies, they don't always give you rehearsal time, but rehearsal time allows you to discuss with your actors while you're at the reading stage, try it this way, try it that way. So that the time you get to the set, there are no surprises. And again, I learned that along the way. It is better to rehearse it. If somebody has a different idea than you, first of all, try their idea out. Generally is going to be better than your idea anyway. But if it's not, then talk to them about what you were thinking. And that way you fix it ahead of time. You've rehearsed it. You've said the words together. You even block it in we'll get a conference room at a hotel or something like that. And we literally put two chairs together if they're in a car, or put three chairs together and now they're on the couch. And we will run it so that the time that you do get to the set, you've figured it out already. So they will be genius when they do their performance because you've already figured it out ahead of time.
Even that word you just used, I think it's the first time today you've used it, genius.
Yes.
When you get a cut you like and you're ready to move on, you yell out genius.
I do. I kind of have two. I have, maybe there's now a third one, but brilliant means that was great, but we got to do it again. There was something off. And it could be the actor maybe didn't get their line right, or the camera went in and out of focus, or the sound, dipped in or something. We have to do it again. And then we do it again. And if it's perfect in all the realms, I say, genius, moving on. And that means it was great. It's time to move on. But it's funny. I did a movie called Reagan starring Dennis Quaid. And I think what Dennis learned with me is once it was genius that he knew I was happy, he always wanted one more because he wanted to play. He wanted to relax a little bit knowing that he had it in the can and now he could try something different. So I had to come up with a new one where it was savant. Like it was the best. It was beyond brilliant and genius. And he loved that. So there's a new one coming into it when it is that good.
After your first movie that you were the full-time official director, what happened next?
Nobody wanted to hire me for 6 years. That was my first movie was Hollywood Chaos. And again, the learning experience, it was an okay movie. It wasn't great. And I had a lot to learn. And so I just thought, I have a movie that people will just say, and let's hire him for another movie and another movie. And what I didn't realize was as a director, you have to have your next script, your next thing that you're going to do. And you need to have that. So over those 6 years, I started directing for Totally Hidden Video, for Candid Camera. Yeah. So these were these shows that would send me out all over the United States. And I got to direct these little comic bits. And you remember with Alan Funt, Candid Camera, where you would play a joke on somebody. And what I got to learn is what real people reacted to in absurd situations. So what it did is it taught me what really people acted like. So that was invaluable for me to bring back to film with me. Yeah. And I absolutely loved it. And it was a great life. I mean, literally, I'd be back in LA in my home for a week and I was single. And then they would send me off to a city, say Chicago, for 3 weeks. And I would fly in on a Monday. On Tuesday, I'd do my first joke. On Wednesday, I'd prep for Thursday and Friday. And I'd have the weekend off in the city. And I would stay at the Marriott, Courtyard by Marriott. So they all looked the same, no matter what city I was in. But it was a way to get to play jokes on people. And the thing about that is everybody was an actor. We would hire actors. The only person who wasn't an actor was the mark, the person we were playing the joke on. And so live, I would have to tell the actors what to say. And I would say this, say that, and over the course of the day, you would work the bit until by the end of the day, you had all your cylinders working perfectly. And the joke would just work incredibly funny. And then there were three ways. We'd get people, just random people on the street.
Yeah.
One where somebody's friend would set them up, or somebody who would come in for work and they would need the work for the day. So then they would be brought into this situation and we would play the joke on them. And it was just, it was fun. It was a learning experience. And it really showed me how to get a real performance out of people, even when they didn't know they were being manipulated into giving that performance.
Television. Yes. I think I've read that you did more than 500 television episodes.
Quite a bit. And I love television because what it does is you have to do it so fast. You have X amount of pages, 7 and 8 pages a day. They want it fully covered, meaning they want wide shots and medium shots and close-ups. And what happens in any productions is things go wrong. They just always do. It's just part of what it is. And so the successful director is the one who figures out, okay, this went wrong. How do we fix it and move on? I remember I was doing a movie called Casper, A Spirited Beginning. It was a sequel to Steven Spielberg's Casper that he produced. And our lead kid actor was sick. Mm. And so he didn't show up till after lunch. So I was shooting inserts before lunch or whatever. So he got there and, we did the best we can. And I said to the producers, okay, so when are we going to make up this half day? And he goes, you have to make today. And I went, yeah, but it's 8 pages. How are we going to do that? And he goes, that's your job. And I was like looking at him like, are you serious? Like, you just took a half a day away from me and I have all these plans and able to figure it out. And he was like, it's your job to figure it out. So I went to the DP, I went to the AD, that's the director of photography, and the assistant director. And we quickly came up with some notes. Although we had planned everything and storyboarded everything, we came up with a new plan and we finished that day on time, on budget. And I was like, okay, so it's possible. But it made my head race at a higher level than I'd ever did. And we had full coverage. It was just different than what we planned. It wasn't exactly that, but we got it in the can. And so once I learned that it was possible, not that I always wanted to shoot like that, but that there's no problem that's insurmountable. So what I find is as soon as something comes up, there's something off or something different, a prop doesn't show up. You know, I might say, well, when will the prop show up? And they go, it's not going to be here for 3 hours. Well, I have the ability to shoot other things before we see that prop for 3 hours. So I learned very quickly, because it's film, because you can shoot something else, shoot something else. And then those things will all get there when you need it and you'll make it work.
How does this affect your personal life? And more broadly, many of us bump into adversity. We hit a roadblock and put the car in park and that's that. You spend an entire career where it never, almost never goes exactly like you imagined. No day works out exactly like you envisioned. And so you're always pivoting left and right, left and right, left and right, genius and moving forward. How do you then take that back and apply that with your relationships, with your son, with your health, with challenges with your parents?
Well, I think it's kind of the same thing. When you bring it back into your family life, I mean, I have 3 amazing boys. And, you know, things don't always go right. Their grades may be at a certain place. And I've just learned to just, you know, joke around with them and go, okay, so you didn't go do so good on that test. Let's figure it out together. Now, 9 times out of 10, I have no idea what they do now. They are so far more advanced than I was when I was their age. But we can get tutors. So let's talk to a tutor, or how can we do it and educate them and be able to pivot in their lives also, and to show them that it's not the end of the world. Like, if you, like, I always love when I go to, you know, soccer games or basketball games, and if they don't win, they're bummed for a little bit. And I go, but that's what it's about. You know, you lost this one, you'll win the next one. And to show them that things don't always work out the way that you plan, but it's okay to feel the sadness for a second and then move on. And then what I love is they've learned it now. And now when I hear them coming back to me with it, giving me my own advice, it is always weird when I go, oh, you actually were listening to me. And, you know, they'll say, oh, Dad, you'll get them next time. Or, you know, say I get a bad review, you know, they'll go, oh, that's terrible, but who cares? Let's go out and have pizza. And I'll be bummed for a second. Then I'll go, you know what? They're right. And so that they've learned that from me is that no matter how bad things can get, let it be bad for a while and then move on from that. And that's how
Let's
I roll.
Talk about that for a moment. What do you do with the bad reviews? You pour your heart. You pour your heart into a project. You fall in love with the story, usually. The actors, I hope. The crew, certainly.
Yeah.
And then the product. And then you put your baby out there for the world.
Right.
And the world has an opinion of it. When that opinion's negative and you read that or hear about it, how do you respond?
Well, first of all, with every film I make, I have this moment before it goes out to the world where I'm happy with it. Like, I work really hard on it to make it as good as I can make it. And I got the music right, I got the visuals right, the color correction, everything looks right, the performances are great. And I literally watch it like I call it the last time before the world will have it. And there are going to be people who love it. Some people love my work, some people don't love the work. It's generally about 50-50. You know, because I will do, for some reason, like Soul Surfer, half the people who saw it hated it and half the people loved it. So it's a very strange feeling.
Half the critics.
Yeah,
hated it.
Yeah, exactly.
The audience loved it.
But it hurts when you see words being written about you that this, you know, how does this director get work? Why is he still getting a paycheck? Because they can be super duper nasty. So what I do in my head, even though it hurts a little bit, I read the good ones and I read the bad ones and I just kind of go, you know, I did the best I could do. For them, it's not right. And I think about it even when I go to the movies. I'm not a reviewer, but there are movies I love and there's movies I don't love. Now, I'm not going to go out of my way to say how horrible this movie was, but I look at it as a lesson for myself because I go, those people set out to make a great movie. What went wrong and how can you fix it? But does it hurt? Absolutely it hurts. You know, you read this stuff, worse than reading it, which is pretty bad because it's almost comical. They can be so mean. I was watching Good Morning America, and my movie Bratz came out at the same time as Superbad. And they were running out of time, clearly, on the show. And I had my whole family, like, sitting around the TV watching this thing. So it was like, oh, they're going to review this movie today. And so they got through Bratz, and it was clearly they were trying to go to commercials. But the guy, because back then, people, there's positive stuff and there's negative stuff. And he just wanted to put something negative out there. And he goes, speaking of Superbad, Bratz is the worst movie ever written. We'll be back after this commercial. And you just, like, got left there. That's all they said. Then they came back, and they had no time for the thing. But he got the words out that it was terrible. And you're, like, sitting there with your family. You're like, oh, my goodness. You know? And was it the greatest or the worst? Like, who knows? It did okay at the box office. But it definitely hurt. But what I decided to do was just, like, I go, I can't do anything about what their opinion is. All I can do is what makes me feel good and the best film I can do. So no matter what they say, I just don't take it seriously. Mm. I mean, I read it for sport. I read it and I kind of laugh. I go, man, it couldn't get worse than this. And then sometimes it does. But then some people have lovely things to say. I'll go to film festivals and people can't be nice enough of how this film turned and how it changed their life or something like that. So I always go, I know I'm putting something decent out there. This is the positive version of it. This is fantastic. So that's what it's about.
You have thicker skin than I. I have my team read the reviews, both online, and as a speaker, we get reviewed every single time.
Oh, wow.
And I want them to review us, but I don't want to be negatively affected by people's bad days.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? But at the same time, you want to take the criticism that is worthy of listening to and apply that to make yourself a little bit better tomorrow than
Absolutely.
You were yesterday.
Yeah.
But I find when I'm reading every review, I take the negative more seriously than the positive. I spend too much personal time on the negative, and that's not ultimately beneficial.
Well, I mean, I feel you. It's not, look, I've seen you speak before, so that anybody could say anything negative is completely beyond me. Because if you look at a movie, people could have a legitimate gripe, and it's just because their taste may be different. But you talk about being inspiring and inspiring others, and you tell your story about what you went through. So this is authentic, it's real. I make different types of films of and how good they are or not how good they are is crazy. I did a movie with Soul Surfer with Carrie Underwood, and she'd never acted before. So she was excellent. She was very good. But you couldn't imagine the haters. So I take it personally, even though it's not about me. I would like be upset that they would do that. And then I just realized there are some people out there that I wish I could reach them and say, you don't have anything nice to say, so don't say anything at all. That my mom used to say tell me that. So I always enjoy that motto because, you know, I'll see something I don't necessarily like, but just don't say anything about it. Just kind of let it go. Critics sometimes feel that people want to hear bad things, so they will come up with the bad things. And you do have to just let it roll off your back and just go, it will be there, but generally more people like it than don't like it. And if you can change one life, why not? Why not make movies like that?
You're known as an actor's director. How does that make you feel?
Well, I think because I went and I acted in high school and college, and I still put myself in most of my movies, just like a small bit. And I understand how hard it is to do what they do. Like, we have these very technical people and cameras and lights and all these things. It's very unreal. And then they have to go in and give a performance. So with the rehearsal, out of respect, working with them, it shows that I respect what they bring in. And I always say, read the script and bring me your stuff so that they feel like encouraged to do that. I've heard other directors say, no, don't do that, or no, don't do that. I will always let the actor do what they want to do. I might say, can you also try it this way as well? But I hear that other directors won't even let the actors give any shot of what they prepared. And I'm like, I don't know how to work with that, because I've been able to work with the cream of the crop as it comes to actors. They are so good, way better than what I could do. And they do it, and I just encourage them and just say, keep doing that. And I think that's why I get an actor's director, is because I listen to them And I let them play. I let them do what they want to do. And so that makes them become better, more relaxed, and give a better performance. And I give them the time. I'll even come up to them and say, oh, you know, this is an emotional scene. You may have to cry. Do you want to start with the close-up, or do you want to do the wide shot where we might not see the tears? And like some people say, no, I'm feeling it right now. Do the close-up first so that they have all of that out there. Because sometimes the tears will go away. So now we're back in the wide shot, so we don't see close to their eyes and stuff like that. But sometimes they say, I'm not feeling it yet. Do the wide shot first. Do their coverage first. And then by the end, I will work myself up to get emotional. Mm. Because it is a craft. It is not necessarily real. Like, I honestly don't care if they're really emotional or not, as long as it looks like they're emotional. And that's what people have to get. Like, some actors... And I always learn this from kids. Kids, you could be doing this death scene, and it's just the most horrible thing, and they're crying and bawling, and you'd say, cut, lunch, and they'd go, okay, what's for lunch? Right. And you'd sit there, and you'd go, like, they had no trouble breaking out of it.
Right.
Whereas other people, you'd have to hold them for 10 minutes after the take as they're shaking because they live the experience.
Yeah.
And so every actor is different, and you just take each actor as they do it. And that's why rehearsal is good, because you get to learn that actor and how what they need and what they want in order to get the performance. For example, I've worked with actors that don't want to wait between takes. They just keep it moving. Because when you say cut on a movie set, usually it takes 5 minutes before everybody gets the makeup back on and the hair. Some actors just want to keep going. So they'll say, just keep it rolling. And I'll say, okay, everybody go back to one, and we roll it again. And then they want to do it right away again because they get the rhythm of it and they don't want that start and stop feel. Yeah. So that's their version of doing it. And I quickly tune into that and say, this is how you're going to do it, and we'll do it that way. And I always ask the actor, tell me how you like to work, and I will work that way for you to get your performance.
You did the sound for the inauguration for Ronald Reagan.
Yes.
40th president of the United States.
Yes.
My understanding is your 40th movie is called Reagan.
Somehow I got the script to Reagan, and it turned out to be my 40th feature film. And it's just a wow moment, because I turned 18 when he was up for being president the second time, because he lost the first time in 1976. They first had a director, John Avildsen, who directed Rocky, and he passed away. That's how I got the gig. And somebody came to me, and I couldn't even understand why they would pick me, because I did Soul Surfer, and I guess that was it. They kind of connected with the sensibilities for that. But I didn't actually meet Ronald Reagan, but I was close to him, and I was plugging in his microphones. And then I did huge amounts of research on him and what he had done. And I had no idea of what I didn't know, yeah. But that's what doing a movie does. You have to do tons of research to find out what that is. So then it was casting Ronald Reagan and Dennis Quaid, who I'd worked with before. Everyone was interested in that, so I called him, and he didn't want to do it at first. He was very like, I don't know. He was my favorite president, and I don't know if I could do him justice. And so I said, well, just read the script, take your time. So then I started taking him places. I took him to the Ronald Reagan Ranch up north of Santa Barbara and brought him to the Ronald Reagan Museum with his family. So I said, just take your time. Don't say yes or no, but just at least get into it. And he ultimately ended up asking his mom, and his mom said, you should do it. You should do the role. So I slowly pulled him into doing the part of Ronald Reagan, and he's just extraordinary at it. Dennis is an incredible actor, and he's a likable guy. And if you remember with Ronald Reagan, he always had a joke, and he was funny and a smile. And look, there were a lot of people that hated Ronald Reagan. And one of my things about doing this movie was to show why did they hate him, to show those parts of his career, Iran-Contra, that he wasn't there backing up people with AIDS when the crisis originally was there. And I said, if I do this movie, it can't be a puff piece about him. It's got to show the good, the bad, and the ugly. And what I liked about it is it showed his whole life. So when he was a kid, I had one actor play him as a kid, and his mom, there would be bullies. And he'd be running up to the house to get away from the bullies. And the mom says, stop, you go out. And if you have to fight him, but don't come out back into this house until you're done. And he literally was a scrapper. He would get into fist fights with kids. When he became the president of the Screen Actors Guild, he would scrape. He would get into fights with the union members. Like, I didn't know anything about Ronald Reagan. Was like older man. Like, I couldn't imagine him as being a young man and virile and having so much life.
Yeah.
And that's what then attracted me to the script. I went, is this real? Did this really happen? And so we were able to actually put that into the movie. So it was just extraordinary to get that chance to make the story and to pick the actors. And Dennis Quaid is extraordinary in it.
You have dozens of opportunities to direct. You get a lot of script placed in front of you all the time. One of them more recently is a little script called On Fire. Yes. First showed up in your life about 6 years ago.
Yes, it did. Wow.
It's been a while. Man.
Yeah.
You read through it and you said, this is something that I would like to participate in. I'm curious why. What is it about that script that you fell for?
Okay. So generally, when I read a script, it happens in the first 10 pages that I'll kind of know that there's something about this that gets my attention, the character, the way it's set up, but there's something that I like about it. And I have no idea. I hadn't read your book yet. I just read a script. And my whole judgment is, do I get emotional when I read it? Because if I can get emotional when I read it, if I could laugh, if I can cry, I go, it's going to be easy once you have real actors there breathing life into it. It will work. But it's really hard when it's just black letters on a white page where you're just like reading it. Can it move you? And when I read On Fire, I was moved so emotionally. And it was just, it was incredible. There were just scenes in it that like I couldn't believe. This young John O'Leary that caught himself on fire and ran through the house and was basically going to die. And his mom said, do you want to live? And what an odd question. I just thought that your mother is asking you that. And he goes, yeah, I want to live. And for some reason, that stuck in me. And I think it was in the first 10 or 20 pages that it just caught my attention, which kept me reading and reading. And then all the characters that came to like this wonderful, you know, for it was an Irish Catholic family. So I connected to it to a little bit. And then what happened in the hospital with the nurses and then Jack Buck. You know, I grew up with Vin Scully out here with the LA Dodgers. So I didn't really know about Jack Buck, but I quickly made the association, you know, the voice of the Dodgers, the voice of the Cardinals, that, okay, I could connect to that. And then I started doing the research on him. And it was like, wow, moments of this. Why would this Jack Buck come into your life? Like, and I'm not exactly sure ultimately why, even after having done the film. The why of it, I'm not sure. But the fact that he did it is inspirational, and we should all be doing the things like that. And I try to instill that into my children to do, you know, we live in Los Angeles. There's tons of homeless around. So all I got is I go, let's go help build bags and go help, you know, the homeless or something, because you got to do something. You got to give back in any way that you can. And I go, here's Jack Buck, who heard the story, your story about what happened to you. And that sort of man inspires me. And I think if I can tell the stories, it will inspire other men to be like that, to pay it forward, to do things. And that's when I originally read the script of On Fire, his character really jumped out at me. Yeah. And obviously your character, the John O'Leary character, who went through just the worst horror of life that one could imagine. I mean, I thought it was bad when I did Soul Surfer, where she lost an arm and she continued to surf. That, like, I thought anybody who does that, that's worth watching that story. And so when your story is you were burned and all of a sudden you decided to get into public speaking, and you're like, how does somebody do that? Why would you want to do that? And yet you brought so much happiness into the world because of that, and change people's lives. And I think that's what we ultimately all should be doing, is if we're given these gifts, I think it's our responsibility to try to go and change some lives and to for the better, and to do whatever you can contribute to society. And luckily, if you can do it with what you love, for you, it's public speaking. For me, it's making movies and telling stories about people. That's what it should be. And wherever you can do that, if you're a production designer, if you play baseball, I mean, we watched the Super Bowl last night and it was just so entertaining. And I thought it brought such drama and joy, and it was just a wow event. And that's, you know, football players. And it's not just the football players. It's the managers behind it, the people who keep the lawns perfectly green, the people who built the stadium in Las Vegas. You know, I just think there's a place for everybody, but you have to go for it. It doesn't come to you. You have to set out to follow your dreams and go for it.
So I'm going to ask you a couple. I know you have three boys, and it's hard to pick your favorite, although if we're not recording, you probably could tell me your favorite. We won't do that today on this recording. But when you look at the movie, when you were shooting in real time, was there a moment where you're like, oh my gosh, I can't believe I'm doing this right now, that we have this backdrop, we have this actor, we have this moment, we have this scene that we're capturing?
Okay, so on this film, On Fire, one of the biggest joys was getting to go to the stadium to watch the Cardinals play baseball. And somehow I ended up there watching, I think, two games I actually got to go to, and I got to sit in a box seat, and I was with your family, and I met just such wonderful people. And it was, again, it was a magical evening. And So at that point, I was still learning the script and learning the people and getting to meet, like, you on any film you meet, literally hundreds of brand new people. Eventually, we got to shoot in the stadium itself. We literally, and there were a lot of rules. We couldn't go on the grass. We couldn't do this. We couldn't do that. So again, that part of my brain that kicks in and went, okay, so we can't go on the grass. Let's build a little bridge over the grass. Let's do this. Let's do that. And I was, somehow they were able to put up on the Jumbotron, whatever it's called now, John O'Leary Day. And I was just standing there looking at the arch behind it and just going, wow, just movie making has brought me to this place with all of these extras and people. And we got to go out on a baseball field and film two or three scenes that were just magical. There's no other way to put it. And it's when first John Corbett, who plays your dad, he plays Denny O'Leary and he drives you around in a wheelchair around all the bases. I mean, I don't think there was a dry eye in the stadium when we were filming that scene. And then later, you drive your dad around the bases. And we had like 6 hours in between it because John Corbett had to change his makeup and go from a younger man to an older man. And so we went off and shot other scenes and went back. But that is pretty just magic to be able to do that. And also, it was a perfect day. Like, there were some bad days, and luckily we were inside, or it'd be rainy or whatever, and we went out there. It was the perfect day at the ballpark to be there and watch it. And we ultimately only had one day to shoot there, and we shot so much in that one day, and it was a beautiful, sunny, perfect day. And that's the magic of it every once in a while. And you learn to appreciate it. Mm. And it was a lot of work. It was high stress getting, because we had to get everybody in, shoot all these scenes and get everybody out in a timely fashion. It was ultimately when the sun went down, we were done shooting. And it was like a race to let's get these scenes shot before the sun drops. So somehow we made it.
There were several days we had to be outside.
Yeah.
And for most of those days, there was a backup plan. So if you had to do it later on, we could flip a couple things. At the stadium, it was this or it's not happening.
Yeah, that was toward the end of the shoot.
And it's December 8th. It could have been 19 and sleeting. And yes. It was 68 and the sun was shining and it was epic.
It was an epic day. And my head is going, if it does snow, how do I cover up, you know, if it's a white and on the field instead of green? And somehow it was perfect. And we also, in my mind, we had to also make it in 1987. So we were playing the modern stadium for the old stadium. And it was a lot of visual effect shots that we were putting in. So in my mind, I'm seeing a whole different stadium for some of the scenes. And yet we're just knocking them off shot by shot. And we got her done.
When audience members in droves of millions and millions and millions eventually go into the theaters to watch On Fire, how do you hope they're moved through that experience? You talked about, John, I was having a bad day, 3 hours off on the sound, went into Steven Spielberg's movie and came out changed.
Yes.
How do you hope they leave this movie a little changed?
Well, I think they will, because I've gotten the experience to not only read the script, read your book, listen to your book, and watch you actually speak to audiences. So what this does, this film captures everything that was in the script, the book, and your live performance. It's all there. So when people are moved at your live events, those elements have now come to life in this feature film. So I think they will be moved dramatically in a way that will want them to go, look, my life may be challenging and hard, but I can see what John O'Leary went through, and I think I can follow my dreams. If he was able to break through what he had to go through, going through a fire and going through those physical things, whatever problem I'm having, I can get by too. And that's what I really want these films to do. I always call them, they're like chicken soup for the soul. Life is challenging. Mm. And there are the most wonderful things in life. There are miracles everywhere. But you have to just keep recognizing that you can follow your dreams and follow your passions. And I think what's going to happen is, for me, it was Rocky. I wasn't a boxer when I was 12 or 13 when I saw Rocky. But I remember just seeing that movie and so inspired. I was like, I even started jogging the next day. And I was like, I'm going to do something with my life. And by that time, I hadn't figured it out. It was a filmmaker. I want people to walk into On Fire, see this incredible story about you, your wife, your kids, your family, and how a whole community came together to help you get through this incredible ordeal, and then come out the side happy, healthier, and in deep gratitude for what happened. I don't think enough people look at setbacks in life and go, well, what did this teach me and how can I go on from there? That is huge to learn from this movie. And I think when people see On Fire, they'll be able to walk away from it and go, you know, that thing that I wanted to do, that painting I wanted to do, that book I wanted to write, that whatever, I think they'll walk away and they'll pull it out of the drawer and they'll start up again and they will start their passion project.
You have an incredible career. You've had a profound impact. You've got a beautiful house. You've got three beautiful kids, an incredible family. You're healthy and vibrant and faithful and joyful. You're being interviewed by a guy who has four kids and a beautiful wife and a lovely life, and they're turning this thing into a movie. For our listeners who feel like, yeah, good for those guys, but that's not my story right now. I don't have those things. My dreams have not yet been accomplished. What's your encouragement to those folks who right now are just struggling a little bit in some aspect of their life?
Well, I'm going to just say for both of us, we both lived the struggle. I mean, my goodness, my 20s, there were days that I would try to get a job and I would call everybody I could call and I would write letters, you know, snail mail. And by 10 or 11 a.m., I was done. There was nothing more I could do. I'd literally crawl into bed and go to sleep for a few more hours because I had nothing else to do. So what I did was I read books. I read Tony Robbins' books. I, you know, 30 Days Live with Passion. I would read self-help books just to get me through those darker days because they will be there and you can feel like nothing will work. But what I think to everybody who is trying to follow their dreams, acknowledge, own the fact that not every day is going to go perfect. But if you can do a little bit towards your goal, and not even by a day, like maybe this week, I'm going to do one thing. I'm going to go get that article at the library, or I'm going to download it from Google or something like that. Do something. And if you can do something, and I met so much failure. That's the thing. People see the result. They see the top of the iceberg. They don't see the years, the hours, that it is such a struggle. But in the struggle, I found happiness. So when I would struggle, I would struggle with other people, you know, and we'd go off and we'd dream. I'd say, let's go to the movies together. And then we'd go to lunch, the cheapest lunch you could find or whatever, go to McDonald's or whatever. But we would talk and go, if I were going to do this movie, this is what I would do. Ultimately, I go, miracles happen and you can never give up. But when you're living through it, oh man, it is hard and it takes years. And I'll be honest with you, I've been doing this for 40 years. There are still days where it just seems like nothing is going right or so forth. And I'm like going, okay, but go back to what I did in my 20s. Do something that makes you happy. For me, it might be going, just go to a movie and just watch it. Or take my kids out and like just go for a walk with them and talk with them. I mean, there's scenes that you have with your dad in this movie where he gives such great fatherly advice. So I will go out with my kids and say, hey, what's going on with school? What's whatever? But just talking to them is enough, because I might be having a bad day and this project's going wrong and this is not going right. And I try so much to get that. And sometimes I just got to break the mold a little bit and go to someplace else and get my energy back and then go back to the projects. But it's normal. It's normal to struggle. And it doesn't always go right. But half of the thing is finding what you want to do. Like actually going, I'm not sure what I want to do. Start thinking about what would make me really happy. Look into those dreams. If it was into baseball, if it was into football, if it's into movie making, dancing, if it's into helping people at the hospital. You may be good at something that all you want to do is help older people. We need those people that can do that. Everybody has their own way of being happy. And I would suggest just try to find a job that you love, that you can be happy with, because then it's not work. Like when I direct, it's not really work. It's just me getting to play with a camera. And I think everybody out there has their passions. I know men that are like in their 60s now, and they were bankers, and they've had ups and downs, and now they just bought their first guitar, and they're learning to play guitar. And I go, you're in your 60s learning rock and roll, for my age people, and they are so happy, and they'll video themselves playing, and it just brings them pure joy. You know, follow and find your joy is what I would say to these people. And it doesn't, when you are down, when it's not happening for you, find something else to just occupy your mind for a little bit. But just know, this gets a little bit spiritual, but if you put it out there, like the, if you build it, they will come. I completely believe in that, because you have to let people know what your dreams are. You can't keep them to yourself. You have to tell people, I want to do this. I want to do that. I wish I could do this. By saying it out loud, they might hear somebody else who might be writing a script. Oh, you should meet with that person. They're a script writer too. And you go, oh, they wouldn't want to meet with me. And they go, well, maybe they'll just meet with you. Maybe they can't write with you, but they'll know somebody that would help you. And it's, there's nothing mysterious about it. By putting it out there, you start to make the connections and you start to meet people that are like-minded and want to do things like you'd want to do. And that's the magic of it. And it is the journey. Trust me. There have been times when I finally got the film done, or I got the funding for this or that. And it's, the joy is in the doing of it. And luckily I learned that at a very early age. It's not just making the thing or getting it done or putting it on the big screen. It was the dinners we had where your mom cooked a home cooked meal for David Brookwell, my partner, and myself, and we would just hang out. Those moments were more joyful than anything of like the filming or the, you know, the final cuts and all of that stuff. And but I learned to enjoy the journey as I go.
That was a fun dinner.
That was a fun dinner.
I was going to maybe ask about that. My dad has Parkinson's disease. Your father had Parkinson's disease.
Yes, he did.
You were in my mom and dad's house. It's not only when you met them for the first time. It's not only when you saw my dad in the wheelchair for the first time. It's when you learn that that is the house actually where the explosion happened. And where all these things you had read about and heard about actually took place. Was the overlap between your father's Parkinson's disease and my dad, did that kind of draw you into the story at a deeper level?
Well, absolutely. When my dad got Parkinson's, of course, and it starts small. It starts with tremors, and then it builds, and he took medicine, and our family did everything we could. We took him to UCLA to get the best treatment, but at a certain point, it just keeps going, and it doesn't necessarily get better. And what was very intense with my dad, his mind was sharp as a tack, like your dad, just incredibly there 100%, but he couldn't always communicate with us. But he would look me in the eye and he would say, I mean, literally, it got really heavy. It just, you got to have mercy. Just end it for me. He would like say these things. And I was like, Dad, don't say that. You know, you can't say that. And then I'd be calling UCLA the next day. What can we do for him? What operations could we do for him? So it was intense because he was an outdoorsy guy. He went swimming and fishing and spearfishing and was in the water and built things. And for him to slowly lose that was intense. So when I met your father and I had been through that, I had a compassion that you can't believe, because I met your father and he was in a wheelchair, like my father eventually was in a wheelchair. And I was like, remember, your dad heard everything and could listen to everything. And so just slow down and have the moments where you really communicate with him. And Denny would speak with me, like I knew he understood what we were saying, but for him to get out his thoughts, it took a little bit longer. So I would just slow down and listen to him. And he was just such a good heart. And such a good man, which very much mirrored who my father was. Just very good person who had this thing happen to him. And what I really appreciated about your dad is he seemed to enjoy everything about life, enjoying the dinners that you get all these new people in your life. What, you know, do they really want to hang out with us? But he, you could just tell he's a good man. He brought up these six wonderful children. And that came across, and I just loved talking to him. And he's a lawyer. He was just so smart, and he had ideas of something, and I would love hearing. And he would, all of a sudden, you'd be in a conversation, and something would come out of his mouth, and you'd go, okay, that was from, like, the conversation 30 seconds ago, but I get it. Okay, let's go back to that and talk about that. And he's just so nice and had such a great opinion about that. So, yeah, it is a journey.
Well, I was with them yesterday. My dad loves you. My mother loves you. Last night, tucking my kids in, Henry O'Leary begged me to let him go on the airplane early this morning. I said, why? You know, I'm flying to L.A., then Dallas and Kansas City, then driving home. It's a long week, man. And he said, I want to be with Sean McNamara. These people end up loving you, Sean. And I have as well. Mm-hmm. And in a directorial position, you don't have to make yourself lovable. You just are. And you don't need to respond to that. Just know that you are Sean Patrick Michael McNamara O'Leary. We've adopted you into
I'm an O'Leary now. That's the best. I tell you.
We wrap every conversation with seven questions. They're called the Live Inspired Seven. So we're nearing the final cut. Here we go, Sean McNamara.
All right.
What's been the most impactful book you've ever read?
Oh, goodness gracious. There have been so many. I love reading books. But one of the books that went right to my heart was A Tale of Two Cities. And I don't know what it was about that book. I read it in high school, and it just showed me other worlds. And it was just at a level that I could read it at. And it strengthened my heart about storytelling. And it takes you to a whole other place. And yeah, so A Tale of Two Cities.
What's one positive characteristic or one trait that you possessed growing up in Southern California that you wish you exhibited as brilliantly today?
I used to play more just by saying, let's go to the beach and just hang out with nothing to do. A lot of my life now revolves around doing work and doing kids and so forth. And I need to get back to that point where I just said, let's just go surfing, because there's nothing more fun than surfing. And it stops all of your other problems, and it's just you in the water. Mm.
The third question, most people think it's about material things, but they have no idea where the question actually came from. You shot the scene that was the genesis behind this question. The third question is, if you could go back into a burning house and grab one thing that really mattered to you, what would you grab? And so before you answer it, this question comes from a 7-year-old little girl named Susie, my little sister, who has an opportunity of running into her burning house and grabbing a Barbie doll or a million other things, and ultimately what she runs in for saves my life. So that's where this question originally comes from.
Yeah.
So, but for the rest of us, a little bit more mature now, a little bit more years behind us, Sean McNamara, if you could run back into your house and grab one physical thing, all your kids are out, the two dogs are out, Bella and Blue are wagging their tails on the sidewalk, and you have an opportunity to do that exactly right now, what would you grab?
I mean, and I think about this because I live in Southern California and there are fires and there are floods and so forth. As long as everybody's safe and everything is fine, I would want to, there are some photo albums that aren't backed up in Computerville. They were from my childhood and they just bring back wonderful memories. And I think I would grab some photo albums that are just filled with just familiar memories of my family, my mom and dad, that are irreplaceable. Mm. It's interesting because my business partner, David Brookwell, he had his apartment burned down when he was in college and everything, he lost everything. And he said it was terrible at first, and then he said it was cleansing. I'm just starting from the beginning. And but everything he had, his earthly possessions at that point, at like 19 or 20 years old, he did lose. So the only thing I could think of is to keep the photographs, because as long as my family is good and I'm healthy, there's nothing in that house that I really need, because as long as I have my health, I can start up again and I can keep going.
If you could sit on a bench on a gorgeous day and have a long conversation with anyone living or deceased, who would you like to be seated next to?
I think John F. Kennedy. I don't know why, but I would just love to hang with that guy and talk about, I just watched how he ran the country at that time. And now I saw him one way as a young kid, and I see him differently now as an adult, and the pressures he must have been on and what was going on in the world. We forget that all the pressure that's here that exists today was back then also. Mm. And that's somebody who I look at, who I go, he was bringing such goodness around, at least my point of view. I know there were some people that didn't like him, but how did he do it? How did he live the life he did with trying to do, you know, not ask not what you do for your country, yourself, ask what you can do for your country. I'm getting the quote all screwed up. But I always like looked at that as going, that's a person worth knowing. Mm.
I love the fact that you just made a movie on Reagan. And half of our listeners are high-fiving you, and the other half just turn off the podcast. Exactly. And then at the end of the conversation, half of the listeners are high-fiving Kennedy, and the other half are turning it off the podcast.
Yeah.
And it's this idea of being open to the opinions of people you might otherwise disagree with.
Yeah.
I mean, there's just, we have to learn from folks
on
the other side of the aisle. And my problem with Fox and MSNBC is they are forcing you to listen through one lens.
Yeah.
And that will... it will lead us down a very dangerous path. I think we're already traveling.
But I grew up at a time, politics or whatever differences are, people could be friends and be okay with the differences that, you know, you have differences. And what do you do with people who are different than you? You learn from them.
Right.
And so I always found when people had a different set of values or ideas, but could communicate why they felt that way, I could at the end of it go, I don't necessarily agree with you, but at least I understand you better.
Right.
And we're all human. We all like face human things. And I think just being able to sit and look at life through someone else's shoes and allow them to tell their point of view and not cut them off, we've lost that gift. I mean, that's one of the things in Reagan. He says, you know, we're going to fight like heck all day, but at 6 o'clock, we're going to go have a drink. And because we keep the fighting at work, but I want to get to know your family, you want to get to know my family, and we will learn so much about each other if we just learn to communicate.
What's the best advice Reagan, Kennedy, mom, dad, Spielberg, or anybody else ever gave you? So the best advice Sean McNamara ever received is?
It's ultimately, I think, especially like from my mom, is like, forgive and move on. She goes, you can't always forget about it, but if you hold on to it, it will ruin you too. So if somebody does you wrong, forgive them and then just move on. Get on with it. And that has been great advice. And it works for everything because, you know, if you really look in their shoes, they didn't necessarily mean to do what they did or they had a different opinion, but just get beyond it and go on with your life.
If you could go back in time just a few years to Loyola Marymount freshman year and whisper some wisdom your way, what advice would you give yourself?
Enjoy the freaking ride is all I can say. I don't know how to do it. I look at my own kids and I go, that you put so much pressure on yourself, even when you're in grade school, even when you're in middle school and in high school. And then in college, you're trying to go, I got to get good grades. I got to do this. I got to do this just to do right. If I could go back to that guy, I'd go, it's going to be okay. Enjoy it. Go surfing more often. Go to concerts. Just, you know, work hard. I'm not saying just, you know, slough off or anything like that, but it's going to work out okay. Not every single decision is the worst thing in your life, but just enjoy the ride.
Sean, Patrick, Michael, McNamara, O'Leary, it has been said that all great people and all great directors can have their lives summed up in one sentence. How would you like yours to read?
He came into this world. He surfed a lot. He wiped out a lot, but he always got back up on the board and went for another ride.
Sean McNamara, 10 out of 10. Thank you for surfing with us, for directing our film, and for reminding the rest of us that the foundation remains firm and the best is yet to come.
Absolutely. And thank you for having me. I enjoyed thoroughly this podcast, but even more getting to make On Fire and just watching scenes with you earlier today, which I'm like looking at him at a whole level. Then I look over at you and I go, oh, wait a minute, this is your story. And I go, this must be the most bizarre thing in the world to witness, but it is the best thing in the world to be able to hang out and call you friend.
I was about to wrap with that. Honestly, regardless of the movie, a great benefit to our family is that we've made a friend in you. And we love you and we're grateful for you. And we wish you all the success in the world with all of your films, in particular, the great film On Fire.
On Fire.
Well, my friends, that is the great Sean McNamara. My name is John O'Leary, and today is your day. Live on fire and live inspired. We'll see you next time.
Well, family, friends, leaders, servants, I appreciate you tuning in to this episode. And I think after you heard Sean's heart, you understand why I love this man, why my kids love this man, why our family loves this man, why successful actors in Hollywood love this man. He's a humble guy. He's a generous man, and he's a servant-oriented leader. Love Sean McNamara. If you enjoyed hearing from him as much as I enjoyed bringing it to you, you might really enjoy the conversation with Coach Kathy Bresnahan. She's the lead character from a future film he was part of a couple years back called The Miracle Season. It's an incredible story. After the captain and the all-star player from a high school team in Iowa was tragically killed, Coach Kathy Bresnahan guided the high school volleyball team through their grief to an unlikely state championship. It's a story of strength. It's a story of faith. It's a story of volleyball. It's a story of perseverance. But really, it's a story of love. It's one of my favorite stories we've shared on this podcast. You're going to love it. If you want to learn more about Kathy's story, check it out at episode 89. Or by allowing your fingers to cruise to my website right now, johnoleary.inspires.com/podcast. We'll have a link to Kathy's episode at 89 in today's show notes. Woof. Well, my friends, fellow moviegoers, I appreciate you being with us during this episode. I appreciate you being part of our Live Inspired podcast family. And I remind you that in spite of the headwinds we face, the challenges that are in front of us, that the foundation is firm, that God is still God, and that the best is yet to come. So for this time and until next time, my name is John O'Leary. Today is your day. What a gift it is. Embrace it and live inspired. At Kelly Companies, it is no secret that they believe in the power of people. In an effort to help their Kellyans get to know each other a little bit better, they decided to launch the Who Do You Know campaign. The goal was simple. Kellyans were encouraged to have a conversation with someone outside of their circle. That's it. These conversations, however, have brought people together and furthered their world-class culture. Shout out to the Kellyans who have made an effort to have meaningful conversations with new friends. You can learn more about those conversations, about those amazing friends, by visiting them online at KellyCompanies.com.